On this show? Are you kidding me?
Okay, I've started recording, and I'm keeping this part in.
Please do.
I'm keeping the part where Dimitri looks like a total tool.
Can you start this part in.
I'm starting right now. This is the start of the show, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. I got a rant here, okay? Welcome to Viz Brevis, the podcast for the individual. In this episode, we interview Liberty activist and Marine veteran. You like that introduction, Adam, there? Adam Kokesh, about his book Freedom, which I am calling a primer for the case for freedom over coercive enterprises. And you can hear the second half of the interview on fullautoshow.com. And in that part of the interview, which we're going to pretend we've already done, we talk about Adam's Freedom Ranch and some of his ideas for creating power for the individual to say yes or no of their own free will. And on the second half of this show, we're going to talk fake news, why it's important to identify disinformation, and some tips on how to separate disinformation from information. But now, Adam, get ready. I got a real introduction for you now, because that wasn't the introduction. Are you ready for the introduction? Are you psyched? Are you prepared? That was pretty grand enough as it was, right? I mean, you can't expect more than that.
Adam looks sleepy. You've kind of inspired that right now. Can you get onto the show now?
Oh, okay. Adam,
scared. I'm as ready as I'll ever be.
Okay, good. Adam Kokesh was a military veteran who saw combat in the Iraq War, and when he came back, he became an activist against the war. He has led demonstrations, engaged in acts of civil disobedience, even been jailed as a result of that activism. And he set up a homestead in, is it Arizona? Did I get that right? I did get that right. Oh, good.
Yeah. Dude, why are you going to set a homestead Freedom Ranch dry?
And
how do you get water out there?
We'll get to that. Listen, folks, we already talked about this in the Full Auto Show, so he's playing with you. And now, without delay, Adam, welcome to the show. Welcome to Viz Brevis. You are in only the second ever episode of Viz Brevis. We started this show last week. Now, we've done Full Auto Show for quite a while, but this show is brand spanking new. So no, welcome.
You're too kind.
Yeah,
you're
I know. Too kind.
Well, I feel like I walked into the wrong person's retirement party.
Your retirement party? You mean your retirement party, right? Because I know you're not talking about me. So we're going to, I have questions for you, Adam. I have excruciatingly detailed questions that will challenge everything you've ever done in your entire life. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
I'm just playing with you. So the first question is, after I listened to the book, I came to view it as, well, I'm calling it elementary apologetics, and I don't mean that as a slight. I have a feeling that you were working on elementary apologetics for authentic liberty. And let me ask you, how far was I off the mark? If I was.
I think you're giving me way too much credit for like intellectualizing this. I really just is basically when I was in jail and people sent me all the best libertarian primers and all the best literature of the libertarian movement of the last, you know, going back to, Bastiat. I mean, if you want to go back even further to, you know, Socrates, people were sending me books on philosophy when I was in jail.
Oh, you dropped a Greek reference. Dimitri will like that.
Dude, okay. This is where I'm not pandering, I swear.
You're pandering to Dimitri. That's
how long were you in jail?
4 months, 2 months in solitary. First and foremost, I gotta say Rothbard and Mises and Hayek and Konkin and Spooner and Thoreau and Molyneux and Rose and Woods and DiLorenzo and Paul Sr. I know I'm forgetting so many. Hazlitt, so many important authors.
You forgot Paul Gordon. I didn't write my book yet, but you forgot Paul Gordon. You should see it in the future.
Yeah. You also
just to send me your book when I was in jail. That was really the inspiration for freedom.
Right. So that makes sense. Yes.
Yeah.
But wait, did Bubba pay you a visit? You've named a lot of important people. What about Bubba?
Bubba
didn't make it.
Well, I was in solitary for the first 2 months I was in jail. Remember, this is for loading a shotgun for YouTube video in the ironically named Freedom Plaza, two blocks from the White House. Local TV loved that clip in D.C. So when I got to general population, I'd been in jail for 2 months already. And the first day, I mean, I was like the only white dude on a block with like 200 guys in there. And I was mobbed by all these guys. But right away, hands stretched out going, dude, we saw you on television. That was awesome. So my first night in general population, I was able to trade $5 in postage stamps for a joint of marijuana. And they taught me how to get away with smoking it in my cell. It was quite an adventure. But yeah, that's so to your question, Paul, like apologetics? No, I wanted the ultimate conversion tool, the ultimate way to show people how we would be better off with a universally nonviolent stateless society and how we can achieve that not with a revolution, but with an evolution that's peaceful and orderly. And really, except for IRS agents, maybe it doesn't pull the rug out from underneath anyone in making this transition, because every time we displace violent institutions with nonviolent institutions, we're going to have a lot more resources freed up, a lot more people happy, a lot less suffering as a result of that coercion, a lot less misallocation of resources. Resources going to what people need rather than what government and its sponsors want.
That's apologetics. You just described apologetics. Yes. Like, this is not apologetics, let me tell you. This is apologetics.
It's not apologetics. I'm saying I don't even know how you mean what the word means in this sense. Like,
it's basically a defense of liberty. You are providing a primer for why it is that liberty is the best choice and why it is that coercion is the bad choice. So so that's all that I mean. There's nothing highfalutin about it. But it does lead to my next question, which does have the word apologetics in it. So prepare yourself. Don't get triggered, man. All right. Now, Dimitri likes it because it's from the Greek.
Adam, so it only gets worse.
It does. It absolutely only gets
worse. He goes into egghead mode, and this is where we start losing people.
I'm not an egghead, man. Dude, I'm not an egghead. I you know what? I like the Philadelphia Eagles. I like football. Come on, man. By the way, I just wanted to check, Adam. You're not a Dallas Cowboys fan, are you?
I like to think of
dude, he hesitated.
He hesitated. Oh man. You know, this is like finding out that Adam Kokesh may be a Dallas Cowboys fan is like watching that Milo Yiannopoulos video today.
No, it's worse.
It's like that kind of level of that's horror disturbing. For me.
Brace yourselves, gentlemen. I'm an arrogant former rugby player who thinks football is for men who like to wear pads.
Okay. You know what? Honestly, that's better than being a Dallas Cowboys fan. I totally do.
Stands for muscle required intelligence, not essential. Remember?
Right.
Yeah. So football is rugby. Too soft for me.
Right. No, I get it. I could take that totally. But I'm going to go to the next question, which is, now you've. I think that you did have a purpose for the book, and I could be totally wrong. And I definitely think – I don't think the book was – I mean, I could sense the structure in the book, and I have questions that will kind of lead to that. But is the book designed I see it twofold. I see it on one hand, it's a simple apologetics primer for, hey, this is why liberty's good. This is why coercion's bad. But I think it's also a book, and see if you agree with me or if you thought about that, that prepares other people, like people who are already crossed over, if you will, to be better apologists, better defenders of liberty, to be able to say, hey, let me tell you why it is that the prison system is not good and why you won't do what you think it will do.
Yeah, that's definitely part of it. I'm glad you point that out because it raises some interesting points about how people embrace this message, because there are some people, you know, who are just raised with the assumption of nonviolence, who are raised open-minded. You give it to them in 30 seconds. Well, hey, the non-aggression principle is a moral foundation for a society because you own yourself and it's wrong to initiate force against another person. And that's why government is an unethical institution and we'll be better off and happier as a society without it. And they go, yeah, okay, that makes sense. But most of us, before we were able to embrace that, you know, had to think through a few more issues. But very few of us really had to thoroughly go through everything. And a lot of us, like, and even as, like, for me, you know, when I wrote the book, I had already been, you know, I'm coming up on 10 years, I guess, a full-time activist for 7 years at that point. But even when I was writing the book, I didn't just, like, write it off the top of my head. Like, I came up with an outline, and I researched stuff, and I pulled out, you know, all your best Facebook status updates and organized them into chapters.
By the way, folks, he meant specifically mine. But go ahead. Go ahead. No, it's cool. It's cool. Go ahead.
So even I had to research it, and it was sort of like a project for myself to say, like, I want this level of mastery of the subject matter that's this comprehensive. And if you read Freedom, and it's been such an honor to see that, you know, in a sense, I read the market correctly. There's a demand for this of people who are reading the book over and over and over again. There are a lot of people who are using it as a tool to proselytize, and they're getting it out saying, like, hey, can you just listen to the first 10 minutes of this free audiobook? Hey, can you just read the first 10 pages of this? You know, and it's enough to give someone that overview and at least start the conversation. But there are people who are reading it. You know, I mean, I've heard people like say, oh, I just listened to it as an audiobook for the 10th time. Or like, it's what I listen to on my commute. I've lost track of how many times I've listened to it. It's like, it's almost weird for me to think like someone's got that much of my voice in their head. Like,
kind of creepy, right? Kind of creepy, kind
of. But I get a lot of people who read the book and are like underlining and highlighting and like really getting that mastery of the material. And if you were to learn that book, like if you were to read the book and just read it slowly and take the time to understand each part of it, you know, just thinking it through, even to master it and practice talking it through with someone, you'll be able to handle any conversation with anyone about this. You'll be able to take any challenge and be able to respond with a comprehensive, you know, in like a really legitimate answer to that is intellectually thorough. And if it's something beyond that, you know, you've already got someone engaged to the point where, like, I like to tell people, the state will not end a day sooner because you read another book about monetary policy. Like, a lot of people who get turned onto this geek out way too much on economics in particular, but, you know, any particular subject matter. It's great that we have experts in all these areas, but especially economics, we see a lot of people, and it's kind of escapism. Like, we can just study free market economics all day long forever. And it's like, no, go learn how to talk to regular people about this stuff, please. Like, let's, that's how we apply this, not by.
So I have a question. I need to back the conversation up a little bit. How did you transition from a Marine to a libertarian?
That's a really
how did you make that switch? How did you go from shooting at people and hoorah to, oh shit, something ain't right here?
Well, if I may start first, the worst of what I did in Iraq was torture people. I never shot at anybody. I never killed anyone that I, you know, in combat. I was a driver. They said, if you're shooting, who's driving, you know? So, and most of the guys that I was with on my civil affairs team who were shooting at shadows, but there was a one night in particular, I was asked to guard detainees and participated in sleep deprivation torture, which is almost worse. But what's really crazy to think, and this actually really relates back to the book and that deeper understanding of freedom as a philosophical concept and an ethical concept, as opposed to just, you know, a nice idea that makes you want to wave the flag and go kill for politicians. So I was always pretty anti-authoritarian growing up. When I was with my mom in the car as a kid, I always had a choice. We could listen to classical music or oldies. And I was like, oh, that's easy, oldies, you know? So now you put on any classic rock or oldies station, you know, I'll know 90% of the lyrics and sing along until your ears bleed. And then, you know, I kind of grew up with that attitude, that, you know, anti-authoritarian, you know, 60s music kind of attitude. And, I got in trouble for blowing up the boys' bathroom in middle school. And it's a long story I won't get into.
Oh, my. Hey, I have an identical twin who's a total state of unstate face. but when he was in, actually, he got you beat. When he was in elementary school, he blew up the boys' bathroom. So there, by proxy, I got you beat.
But I love it.
So how does?
But he ended up being the statist.
So how did you go from being anti-establishment, anti-authority to Marines, and then how did you transition from Marine to?
Yeah, that's you were like a yo-yo there.
Well, no, it gets worse than that. It gets worse than that. See, like in high school, at some point, they asked, do you want to be a Republican or Democrat? And I said, wait, I have to be lame. I don't have a choice, really. And they're like, well, there's these crazy libertarians over here. They like to be left alone. And I was a punk, you know, I was a real punk kid. And I was like, yeah, libertarian, sign me up for that. So in high school, I even identified as a libertarian, but I did not understand the message philosophically. I got the watered down, politicized message.
Did you get the essentially the I'll say the libertine message? You
know, no, it was fiscally conservative, socially awkward. I mean, socially liberal. Excuse me. Yes,
that makes more sense. Yes,
socially liberal, fiscally conservative, and this is a common sense set of political positions. Not this is a moral philosophy that is essential to humanity moving forward right now. And so I saw Full Metal Jacket as a kid in high school. I also went to this thing called Devil Pups, which is like junior boot camp that they send kids to instead of juvie sometimes, except most of what I did that would have sent me to juvie I did after this. But this was my first exposure to the Marine Corps. And then, you know, I saw Full Metal Jacket, and the line is, I wanted to be the first kid on my block with a confirmed kill. And I really thought that if my government decided someone needed to die, I wanted to be the one pulling the righteous trigger. And
the righteous trigger, right. The righteous trigger.
Yeah, that's, I mean, it's like the most embarrassing thing I can admit to in the whole rest of my life is how I, my entire past is how I, you know, really, even in the Marine Corps, felt like that spirit of, you know, independence rather than obedience, and yet rational.
How did you hold on to that through Marine Corps training?
I think that's closer to my core personality. That's who I really am. And like I said, it was just rationalization that made it possible for me to go through with all of that obedience of being in the Marine Corps. Like, I just, you know, part of it is insecurity. My parents got divorced when I was 10, and so that really altered my relationship with authority, and I felt, I think, from that a kind of lack of security in a family that, you know, a normal family upbringing might give someone. So that, you know, really motivated me to want to have my life on the line for something I believed in. To like, there's a certain validation, you know, and they really sell the Marine Corps on this, you know, in a lot of subtle psychological ways, like, you know, hey, join the Marine Corps, you'll be one of the cool kids. You know, hey, you'll always have a good paycheck. Hey, you'll always have a purpose. Hey, chicks will always dig you. You know, old people will both blow smoke up your butt.
And when you come home, people will buy you beer.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it was all of that. And I,
hey, you know, I'm going, like, to go join now. You sold me.
And hey, no, this is just like Full Metal Jacket. It's supposed to be an anti-war movie, and it really wants.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Can't even talk about it. But no, that was a big part of it for me. And then when I went to Iraq in 2004, I volunteered. I was in a reserve civil affair, or excuse me, reserve artillery unit, so that I could go to college.
So, dude, and you were a red leg? Oh wait, red legs are, yeah. Red legs is an army term. That's, yeah, you got, army, you Marines.
But yeah, Marines, we would. String pullers, you know, pull string, gun go boom.
Sandbags. Navy, yeah. Calls you sandbags.
I liked being in the artillery. It was fun. Some of my hearing's messed up.
Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know your hearing's messed up.
What equipment were you on?
M1 9 or 8 howitzers, 100 millimeter. Yeah, 155 millimeter. 100-pound shells, 50-meter kill radius, 100-meter casualty radius.
Dang.
Range into, like, somewhere in between 10, 20 miles. I mean, these things can go a long ways.
That's a wonderful toy.
Standard, no. You know, pretty standard artillery equipment. The Army had the self-propelled version. We had the towed version. It was more
so work. did you run artillery while you were there? Or you were in something else?
Yeah, I volunteered from my reserve artillery unit to go active duty with civil affairs to go to Iraq. Because I was actually against the war before the war. Like, I really didn't abandon, you know, my free-thinking nature completely. I went to the day of student walkouts when I was in college as a reservist, saying that not on any principled grounds, just like, hey, this war is going to be a bad idea. Like, it's not going to be worth it for America to invade and occupy or like and take over and do something in Iraq. Like, it's not like I didn't buy the oil is going to make it pay for itself or any of that kind of silly stuff. But I really believe that what we were doing was cleaning up our mess and responsible foreign policy. And I volunteered to go before Saddam got caught. And then he got caught. And I remember being really disappointed. Like, I haven't even gotten to Iraq yet. I didn't get my chance. Did
you wanted to catch him? You wanted to be the guy?
I want to be the guy to catch Saddam.
Well, you wanted to pull him out of the spider hole.
It wasn't the Marines that caught Saddam.
I know it wasn't
the Marines. Wouldn't have been the Marines.
Oh man, it was some hard charging boys. I can tell you that much.
So let me get to the next question. Actually,
let me wrap this up real quick. Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay. No problem.
You got me tripping down memory lane here. But then when I got out of the Marine Corps, when I got back from Iraq, I went back to college. I was dealing with PTSD. And volunteered to go back because I didn't get a Purple Heart the first time. That was really my motivation. And they flip a sick switch in your brain that way. And I got in trouble for having brought a pistol back the first time I went to Iraq. And that caught up with me
Can I ask what kind of pistol?
Yeah, it was a 9mm Beretta, really cool one. It had been a gift from Saddam, like these little gold medallions on the pistol grips.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I don't want to get it. That's a whole other long story. I was really stupid about some stuff in that. But anyway, I ended up sitting at Camp Pendleton for a year managing a barracks. And this, Demetrius, to really finally answer your question, what made the transition for me is that when I got out of the Marine Corps, they gave me a Navy Commendation Medal for my tour in Iraq 2 years prior. And then the next day busted me down from sergeant to corporal. And I had just spent a year as a sergeant who spoke Arabic with civil affairs experience managing a barracks at Camp Pendleton going, this sucks.
I bet.
And so it wasn't because I'm smart. It was because I was pissed off. Like, I was just disgruntled enough to start questioning things. And that's what really sent me to the bottom of the rabbit hole to understand that government is fundamentally unethical because it's not enough to be against one war. You have to really be against all wars when you realize the nature of war. And when you realize the nature of all wars is, you know, poor men dying for rich men's profits, it's all a racket, like Major General Miller said.
It's funny.
Even enough to be against that, you have to be against militarism. And then you realize, well, no, it's statism itself. It's this idea of solving problems with violence, of setting principles aside, of arguments from effect and consequence and the consequentialist analysis and things like
that. It's funny that people who came back from World War One, actually people who resisted World War One, Paul is familiar with that documentary whose name is...
And try to find that documentary. Good luck. It was on Netflix. Yeah. It's called The 14 Diaries of the Great War. Incredible. There are versions of it on YouTube, and they're kind of funky to look at, but it's still worth it because they're kind of they're stretched or weird. Well, but that documentary, the best war documentary that you'll ever see, where it really covers. Well, I'll let you make your point to me. You're probably going to say what I was going to say.
It's a tremendous documentary, but that outlines it. The guys coming back from like World War II who start, you know, motorcycle gangs like the Hell's Angels, who are completely rebellious against the system. There are episodes within Western civilization after every war, including Vietnam and Korea, where guys come back and they say, this is fucking nuts. What we did was the wrong thing. We are on the wrong side of morality with what we did. And how did I get sucked into this?
Mm-hmm.
And it happens over and over and over again. And the system seems to have good answers and good mechanisms with which to marginalize those people with those important questions. After World War One, there were marches on Washington. After World War Two, you had protests. After Vietnam, you have
during
all these Vietnam,
Vietnam vets. During Vietnam, right.
But the vets who came back, they're all looked as nut jobs. You know, oh my God, he's a Vietnam vet. Is he going to murder someone? Is he a homeless guy? Is he this? Is he that? There are these narratives that are created each and every time to marginalize those who experienced it and who come back and say, wait a minute, there's something wrong with this system.
Well, there's a fair number of people. And I mean, Adam, you were in it, so I'm sure that you, I don't know if you have connections with your friends from your service or not, but a fair number of people, I mean, I've met a few that had hard combat, especially the ones that have seen upfront combat, where the nakedness of the state, and this is why that documentary that I talked about is so great, that 14 Diaries of the Great War, the nakedness of the state becomes so raw and so bare. It's not hidden behind sanitized language anymore. There's one point in the Great War where you have these children, they're showing these different diaries from children in different places, and they're all drawing these hateful pictures. The German kid is drawing hateful pictures about the British and the French and calling them horrible, vulgar names. And meanwhile, the French kid is drawing these horrible pictures about the Germans and calling them these horrible names. And meanwhile, their own governments, as the documentary goes on, their own governments take from them more and more and more because they're so desperate to win this war. And it becomes, and people are they're leaving their patrols, they're walking away. They're fundamentally walking away. And then America comes in and America, quote unquote, saves the day. I don't know if anarchy would have emerged at that moment in time, but I believe it was one of those opportunities.
It most certainly would have if America hadn't joined.
I believe it would have if America had not intervened.
Anarchy looks like in the Great War, anarchy looks like the Christmas truce.
Right.
Exactly. That's exactly what it was.
Yes. Where
people who think they pull the strings say, "Go kill each other." And the people on the field say, "Fuck you, we're going to be friends."
Right.
The problem in the Great War was they had these trenches, and they're so close to each other, and they could talk to each other, and they could become human. The minute that you become human, you lose it.
Yeah.
I mean, and that you cover that a bit in your book as well.
Well, that was a part of my experience in Iraq, and it's been something I talked about a lot when I was active with Iraq Veterans Against the War, and that is the dehumanization of the enemy that takes place, that is part of the conditioning that still happens. And, you know, I don't want to even mention them to reinforce them, but there are, you know, a handful of pejorative terms that you've probably heard about people in the Middle East that are used as common terms by people in the military that simply make it easier to oppress and kill them. And, you know, what we were really doing was imposing martial law. And when you mention, you know, all the military history, I like to think of the documentary Sir No Sir about Vietnam Veterans Against the War, who were great mentors to us in Iraq Veterans Against the War, who after VVAW was no longer relevant, became very active with a great organization that I'm a member of called Veterans for Peace. And if anybody's a veteran who wants to just have their name on that list, I highly recommend they look that up, Veterans for Peace. And it's a pessimist would be tempted to say that the one thing we learn from history is that we never freaking learn from history. But I would like to think that we learn slowly, at least, and in every way, except perhaps the spending. But even in that sense, the Iraq War is a shadow of the Vietnam War in terms of the scale of the viciousness and the violence.
Yes.
And I take great hope in looking at the decline of the scope of war over the last 100 years, that it gets harder and harder for governments to make war, to convince millions of gullible young men and women to meet in the middle of a field where none of them live and kill each other because they're wearing different colors. I mean, the preposterousness of that is now laid bare in the age of the internet when they've been trying to get a war going with Iran for decades. And I could Skype someone in Iran right now and go, "Hey, do you hate all Americans over there? Hey, no, we don't. We really just don't like some of the things your government is doing. Hey, how about that?"
And, you know, Iran is a very sophisticated culture. I mean, they have a highly advanced society there. And, you're having a harder time getting people ginned up to hate Iran. I mean, you're always going to get a certain group, but even Russia, nobody wants to fight Russia.
Wait. I got it. Okay. Listen to this.
Okay.
The French are now blaming Russia for the lack of enthusiasm amongst socialists in the French elections.
Yes.
The French are now blaming the Russians. Another good boogeyman. But let's back up to Iran for a second. Iran fought four. Do I have the right number of fingers up? Four wars in the 20th century. They were attacked all four times. Who's the bad guy?
Yeah, who's the bad guy? Right.
They want nukes. They want nukes. Why? They were attacked four times by the British, the Russians.
Russia. Russia's surrounded by U.S. military bases, but they're threatening us.
And then the Iran-Iraq war, which we precipitated with giving Iraq all those chemical weapons to fight against Iran. And the Iranians want nukes. Why?
Yeah, well, of course.
Because we fought how many wars in the 20th century?
Well, of course, on one hand, I made a video about this a long time ago. I thought it was going to get some traction. It never did. But to me, it's a fascinating idea, is that if the people of Iran wanted a guarantee that they would never be invaded by the American military, there's one easy answer. Stop being Iran. Dissolve the national government of Iran. Become, a confederation or even just a loosely affiliated group of small local communities where government runs at that level, and there's essentially nothing to attack. There's no longer an excuse.
Well, that's a guarantee for attack, because then the West would see that as a horrible threat, and they would have to respond and say,
we can't let this happen. They'd get to use the Afghanistan defense, which has beaten the American and the Russian empires already. Anyway, part of me wants to say, like, yes, the country of Iran has a right to self-defense and should be able to get nukes. But of course, they're not a legitimate government in the first place, because there's no such thing as a legitimate government, and no one should have nukes. I mean, it's really freaking insane. I would hope that
I'm saving up.
I would hope that this becomes an issue again.
I'm saving up. Okay.
All right. Nuclear tools for productive purposes. I have no problem with the market.
$10 a month is what I'm saving up, man. I'm gonna have it soon. Can't
nuclear
wait.
No, I mean, the idea that in this day and age we still have nuclear weapons pointed at each other, this is silly. Like, this is beyond silly, because it's so tragic that it's silly that we even live in a world where this is possible, where we haven't gone to the point of, like, let's just disarm all the governments, at least to the level they don't have nukes. Can we just do that, you know? And it's...
I'm all for disarming governments, but arming individuals to the teeth.
Oh yeah, I belong to something called the Bear Nukes Caucus, which is, what weapon should an individual not be allowed to buy? My answer is none. So, you want people to have tanks? Hey man, if you can afford a nuclear weapon, hey, have at it. Now, how many people can actually afford it?
May I try to answer that first of
sure,
all?
Sure, go ahead.
Good luck with that one.
In an ideal stateless voluntary society, there is no one to forcibly prevent you from getting a nuke. But having a weapon of that scale requires an immense amount of
coordination
and consensus that would never happen in such a society.
I agree. It's just an exercise, a demonstration of where I stand as far as limiting people and their power to purchase weaponry. Hey, okay, let's just go to nuclear war, or let's just go to the nuclear weapon. We're just going to go ahead and put that out there so you know where I stand unapologetically. Wait, but I agree with you, Adam. I don't think a nuclear weapon is practical in a voluntarist free association communities.
I'll go further in the disarmament direction, because I have as much credibility as anybody does on the gun issue, having gone to jail for that. And as much as I'm pro-gun right now, pro-gun in the short run, I'm actually anti-gun, not by way of government regulation, but by way of technology rendering it obsolete in the future. And it doesn't mean you wouldn't be able to have whatever weapons you want on your own property. I wouldn't stop you from that. But at the point at which we have a phaser, that's actually like Star Trek style, that's better than a gun for stopping someone, that like you can shoot them in the pinky toe and it's gonna stun them and disable them that, enough that you can, you know, put them in handcuffs or tie them up and preserve the value of that person's life. I think the idea of carrying a gun is going to be an unnecessary danger that you just, if you were to come on my property at that point, I'd be like, no, you know, we're not doing guns here. We're doing, you know, the higher tech, safer stuff.
When you get phasers, I'm all in. But even if you get phasers, I love guns for a lot of reasons. I love the mechanics. Yes. I love the mechanics. I love all that. So I believe I would probably still have guns. I wouldn't carry them. I wouldn't need them.
So and in that way, like, I would have no problem with you having guns on your own property or on your friend's property or on anywhere that it's welcome. But I think there would be an expectation that, like, you wouldn't carry a gun into a public
sport. It would probably be considered gauche at that point, because then it's like, yeah, what do you really need it for? You have self-defense. You're fine. Yeah. So I want to wrap this segment up.
Wait. Assuming that phaser can take on the state, then yes.
Yeah, of
but
course
until,
it can.
But until the phaser can take on the state,
and I think that's
I'm
Adam's
still going
position.
For my.
I think that's Adam's position. Yes,
I'm still going for my gun. But wait, there was another important question I wanted to ask.
All right.
So, when you got to the point where you were disgruntled with the military, how did you transition from that to I'm going to rack a 12 gauge in Washington, D.C. and not get shot? First of all, how the hell did you not get shot by the local authorities? Because they're kind of gun happy about shooting people with guns.
Well, you heard, you know, right? I'm Jonathan Brandis, an undercover CIA agent.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that. That's right. Yes.
So how did you, one, not get shot? And two,
I always forget
how did
that.
How did you go from disgruntled military guy, which is pretty common with military guys, to to activist?
To
what was the transition there?
Well, I wish I could blame alcohol, but no, unfortunately I can't. Well, when I got out of the Marine Corps, November 30, 2006, I moved to D.C. to get a master's in political management at George Washington University. And I came across the website Iraq Veterans Against the War, and I just knew that I had to have my name on the list. That was it. And I fell into full-time activism by accident, first with Operation First Casualty, which was a mock combat patrol on the anniversary on March 19th in 2007. And I consider that the start of my full-time activism. I made the front page of the Washington Post with that, just because they used a picture of me. And I got in trouble with the Marine Corps for protesting in uniform, which was silly because it was street theater. We weren't impersonating anyone in the military. We weren't even wearing proper uniforms deliberately. So I got called before a kangaroo court in Kansas City and played that up pretty big. And it was my first, major national media story that was centered on me. And it was while I was surrounded by a lot of the lefties in the anti-war movement. It was like I figured out, I really had to be right about everything. But I was going to think about being right about everything and call myself a libertarian. So I started doing the research. I started watching a lot of documentaries. Zeitgeist was a big one. America Freedom to Fascism was a big one. Ron Paul, being a Ron Paul supporter, was a big influence on me. And then reading Rothbard, Ethics of Liberty, was the final, the bottom of that part of the rabbit hole. Although I will say, the only time you're wrong is when you think you're at the bottom of the rabbit hole, because there really is no bottom. It just keeps going. But there is kind of a bottom of the rabbit hole in terms of your understanding of violence and force and government, and how government is an unethical institution that we should be working to move past as fast as we reasonably can.
So technology is allowing us to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the last chapter of your book. You get into that. I have one last question here for this segment here, and that is our show. I told you before the show that our show is designed to reach a broad swath of people with, at minimum, that they agree that government is at best a necessary evil. Now, if they agree it's an unnecessary evil, that's better. But if they believe it's a necessary good, probably not a lot of common ground there. as I talk to these people, what I hear in common with a lot of these folks, and believe me, there are some people on the left that also believe that government is a necessary evil. And they'll agree in principle that the emergence of more power of the individual to say yes or to say no of their own free will is always a good thing. And they're willing to go where the emergence of individual power takes them. So my question for you is, how closely are you willing to work with, walk beside, promote, collaborate with people who only believe that government is a necessary evil, but they're willing to work to empower individuals to say yes or no and follow where that power emergence leads them?
Okay, that was confusing. Can you summarize that, please?
I got it, but if you don't mind me taking a little extra time to answer that.
Go ahead.
I'll start by pointing out that from my experience, most individuals like individual power. How about that? And I see this as not a revolution, but an evolution. And it's an evolution towards freedom, away from violence, away from institutionalized coercion and force. And I want to celebrate everyone and everything that is moving us in that direction. And some people would even say it's not tyranny versus freedom as much as it is love versus hate. And there's a deeper evolution going on here that I think is really important to appreciate as well. So it's important that we live by those values of nonviolence, of freedom. And really, freedom is about love. It's about bringing people together. It's about making society more harmonious and peaceful and productive. And so everyone can be happier. It's not about smash the state or be right about everything. So I look, you know, at the Bernie Sanders phenomenon as a beautiful thing that, you know, everybody was, he really won the Democratic primary, right?
Right. That most people, right. Well, the Russians hacked it. And
that most people voted in the Democratic primary were looking for something fundamentally philosophically different. And on the Republican side, that they were so desperate for something anti-establishment that they were willing to go for Donald Trump, you know?
The Orange King, right.
Yeah, our first orange president. I think it's a major...
You know what? I'm getting beclempt. You're right.
I think it's important to appreciate, you know, just disagree with him. At least, you know, be respectful of the ethnic diversity that he brings to us.
That's my point. That's been my point.
And listen, my point of view is two things about him that make him attractive. One, he's not a lawyer, and two, seriously, and two, he's a wrench in the system. He's a wrench in the cog.
He's definitely a wrench in the cog.
We'll see about that. No, that remains to be seen.
That's true. That's true. So far,
he's
possibly.
Look, when the likes of...
Not good. And he's committed to increasing military spending,
yes,
which is
okay.
The fundamental racket of the government. He's not challenging...
He hasn't backed off of no fly, no buy either.
Yeah.
Let's see. If he represents a significant scale down of militarism despite increasing the budget, I'll be willing to give him, you know, to eat a little crow. But no. I'm not holding my breath for that.
When the likes of McCain have a problem with Trump, can somebody answer for me why the Vietnamese didn't off that jerk?
There are a lot of pro wrestlers who are libertarians because they understand white hat, black hat, showman bullshit. And you're falling for it.
No, I'm not.
He's being a devil's advocate was what he's
absolutely
doing. Yeah.
Well, if I may, I'm planning on running for president in 2020 on the platform of the peaceful, orderly dissolution of the entire United States federal government.
And
so I don't even think it's about this philosophy necessarily. I don't think we have to bring everybody on board with exactly this way of thinking, people who get the core philosophy and end up agreeing on 90%+ of the issues, because it's one issue that moves us forward. And this is in the book in chapter 10. And remember, it's free in every digital format possible at thefreedomline.com, free audiobook. And what's so important about what it presents is how we can move forward from this through localization. We can take governments apart from the top down. We don't have to convince everyone that they should be free, but if you feel like you still need to be governed, would you rather be governed at a more local level where your voice and your vote have a chance of mattering, or by someone in some far off capital like Washington, D.C., where we know the average opinion of Americans is irrelevant to the policy that gets passed, because when power is concentrated that way, it's very easily corrupted by lobbyists and special interests. So well, we can localize government down to the state level. And I think when we get rid of the federal government and we have a peaceful transition down to the states, people are going to be so excited about that and so much happier and freer and more prosperous that they're going to say, let's keep going. And that's how this is going to happen. They're going to say, well, let's get rid of state governments. Let's get rid of county governments. And it's when you get down to the city and the community level that you can transition the remaining government systems to nonviolent systems and render the violent systems obsolete with nonviolent systems that displace them entirely.
You're preaching to the choir here, but here's, I mean, I talk to people all the time. Hell, I got a ride back from the dealership that was working on my car, and I was talking to the guy who was driving me back to my job. And he goes, dude, why don't you run for president? Because everything that you're talking about, like, resonates with me and everyone I know. And my answer to him was, because I like my brains inside my skull.
And on that note, I'm going to wrap this segment up. That is a beautiful way to end a segment.
I wanted to make a point.
Oh, okay.
The point is, I think the path is correct. I think the technology is there to get us there. I just think right now it's a little premature to think that the average American is gonna sign up for this. I think there's a lot more education that needs to take place.
Yes. Well, let me please say two things about this. This campaign, people ask me, are you running to win or to educate? And the answer is yes. We are going to educate enough people so that we can win. And we are not pandering. We are not going out to make me look good. I don't really care. And if we can win over enough people with the message, then we have a critical mass that can move forward on this idea. And I will keep running until we win on this platform or the federal government ceases to exist by collapse or a widespread secession movement. But compared to that, I'm offering let's do things the easy way. And,
please keep your brains in your skull.
Oh. Yes, keep your brains in your skull.
Good. They're never going to shoot me, because shooting me would mean that more people will read my book.
Yeah, right. Now, I'll end this segment there. And first of all, Adam, thank you so much for being on this Preface. We love having you on. I'd love to have you on again sometime and talk a few other things about your book that we didn't get to. But that was fine. By the way, folks, one of the things that you guys witnessed was, emergence. You witnessed... People ask anarchists, for instance, how are you going to see, how's this going to work? How's that going to work? And most anarchists, most of them will tell you, I don't know, because it's going to emerge, emergence. So our show was kind of a demonstration of emergence. Began with a plan, something else emerged, and that was okay. We let it emerge. So before we go here, on the other side, we will be talking fake news. Dimitri and I will be talking fake news. And how to identify it, why it's important that you identify disinformation. And Adam, give everybody, where can they contact you? What are the key things you're doing right now? Promote yourself.
Don't forget, you're reaching an audience of like 12 people. Out there right now, dude.
You're going to reach at least 15 people. Come on, dude.
Well, I'm going to share this with my people, and then they're going to share this with their people.
Yeah, there you go.
People and with their people. And then, in like a few weeks of this video going viral, we'll be ready to abolish government.
That's it. And it'll all start with Paul Gordon. Yes! All right. I'm humble,
Ladies and gentlemen, you see, if you're watching this right now, you have the power. This interview could be the beginning
of It could be the tipping point. So go ahead, give out your Freedom Line, and where can they find you on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, all that stuff?
It's all through thefreedomline.com, thefreedomline.com. You can find the Kokesh for Not President website, which has a little bit more information about the platform and how we would dissolve the federal government, spin things off, privatize things, localize things agency by agency. And you can find me on all the social media and my YouTube channel, which I think, what We just hit 56 million. And I have a lot of videos on private that don't get counted in that. But 56-something million, you can find all that through through my channel. I do a lot of man on the street videos where I go talk to people with a stick mic and do a kind of Socratic dialogue thing, putting them on the spot. And got a really fun video
again
like
with
that
the Greeks.
Today.
Again with the Greeks.
Right. Hey, couple really quick things for you, Adam. If you haven't heard of these guys, I suggest you look them up. And maybe you already have. You already know about them. One is Dylan Robinson, a friend of mine. He does veteran anarchy. I strongly suggest you check that out. I think you find something that resonates there. And the other thing is Cal Molinay from Liberate RVA, who's doing a lot of great work. What's that?
I've seen some of his work.
Okay, yeah. Cal is awesome. He does a lot of man on the street stuff, and he's great. I've had him on a show that I used to do called Disassociation Nation. So we'll see you on the other side. And Adam, thank you very much for being on Vis Previs. And don't forget to check out the other part of this interview, which is on fullautoshow.com.